just pulled up this table from the BSCSE because I feel like this is probably like the worst possible way to try to study. It's like an overwhelming list of things. So that's kind of similar to trying to learn birding. You just put them all together in one, you know, big poster, all these little wild birds look the same. So I just put this photo in here. This is a photo of myself in med school slash grad school. Just reminds me, because I entered med school with bad grades, I was assigned a studying coach, which actually was really helpful in that she taught me, you know, some things that I didn't really know about memorizing things. She said, always, you know, group things in 3 to 5, use repetition with increasing intervals, and give yourself explanations for why things are the way they are. So humans can only remember about 3 things. That's why we have, you know, life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. That's why Obama in his speeches frequently, you know, uses the rule of 3. So this is a photo of a dog with a vacuum cleaner, just because it reminds me of how I taught my dog to tolerate the vacuum cleaner is actually kind of similar to how I tried to memorize things in medical school. You know, at first I just turned it on for like 5 seconds and I had to do that multiple times a day. Then once he got okay with that, then I was able to turn it on for longer and do it like once a day and once a week. But then sometimes if I went too long without vacuuming, then he would forget how to tolerate the vacuum cleaner and have to start over. Use those increasing intervals as your familiarity increases. This is just a reminder that humans remember stories. So, you know, when we read this like really boring article about deforestation, we don't really take away anything. But when we read The Lorax, you know, we all remember that, you know, trees are important. So I just try to give myself explanations of like, this is why it is the way it is. So. As far as the, at this point, let me just show you. So I feel like my brain is kind of like my computer. If I don't organize it, I won't be able to ever find anything again. Hi, Eileen Hwang. Yes. Oh, okay. You're in the lobby? Okay, I'll have BK go out and meet you. Thank you.
We'll get the Burger King, BK.
Okay. So I just wanted to show you, like, you know, I feel like I can't remember everything, so I try to organize, like, for example, all the papers, you know, that I've read, I try to file them away in PDF form so I can find them again. Because, anyway, but I try to organize my brain, too, so that I can find things. So the way I've chosen to organize these disorders is by their ocular phenotype. You guys have come up with some really great ways to organize and link these diseases together as well. So we can try to tie that in as we go. So there's the things that look like RP. I'm also lumping some cone rod type of phenotype, bullseye, you know, maculopathy type of phenotypes in there, as well as LCA, like really severe, like when you're young, nystagmus type of issues. I also put the macular problems together. I don't know if you've seen this drawing before. This used to be the default of what Epic thought the macula looked like. So you're welcome to help yourselves to breakfast while we talk. And then fundus hypopigmentation, so things like albinism, myopia and retinal detachment, peripheral non-perfusion, and then another, because there's always things that don't fit. So we'll start with the biggest group. The vast majority of these inherited diseases that affect the retina and the rest of the body cause a phenotype that's like RP, LCA, or cone rod. So since there are so many of these diseases, I've kind of subdivided them, as well as made some gross generalizations about all the different types. So, gross generalization, so a lot of these are enzymes, and for enzymes, they, if you have like half of the amount of enzyme, there's so much excess enzyme, it's still gonna like do its job. For example, enzyme is supposed to degrade, you know, this thing, then if you have half of it, it's still gonna degrade kind of enough to get rid of it. But if you have none of that enzyme, that's when you really have problems. So that's how I remember that most of these diseases are autosomal recessive. And another way to remember that they're recessive is that a lot of them are really pretty bad for your health, not just your eyes, like everywhere. And therefore, like if this was an autosomal, it wouldn't make sense for it to be autosomal dominant because you wouldn't then pass on your, keep passing on that gene. It only survives in those people that are heterozygous, because those are the ones that are reproducing and then passing it on. A lot of these diseases have really significant neurological problems, either neurodegeneration, death, like Batten's disease, or just kind of developmental delay. So the way I categorize these is by the different parts of the cell that are affected. So I think, we're gonna split people into teams. So let's see. How should we best do this? Should we do this half and then this half? Okay. I'm gonna call this.
They have Mubarak, so they'll be fine.
Okay. He's been studying since 4 a.m., so. Is it not a good grouping? There's too many junior people on this side.
No, this is great.
We have Brandon.
We should actually put money on the line.
Wait, what if we do like front row and back row? Yeah. Okay. I think it's fine.
Yeah.
We'll do front and back. Okay. So we also probably need a man of white to keep the score. Is there any volunteers for that?
Don't put on.
Okay, Abigail's volunteering to be man of white. So,
do you want me to put on the board?
Yeah, so we're just gonna have like a front and then back. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so anyone have a guess as to what this like red organelle is here?
It's a cilia.
Right. Oh, shoot. All the answers showed up at once. The cilia.
Points.
Okay. All right. How about one of those? She gets a point. So how about these other organelles I'm trying to depict? How about the blue one? What do you think I tried to draw there?
The powerhouse of the cell.
Maybe Tyler was the loudest and quickest, so you can give the back a point.
Can we just like yell it out? Okay.
Wait, who's on the front?
Out. Read the back of us.
Okay. And then how about these other two organelles in orange and green? Any guesses?
Lysosomes.
Lysosomes are major. What else?
Peroxisomes.
Okay. All right. Tony, we got the peroxisomes loudest. So.
we're screaming.
Yelling. And then how about this like weird thing that I put there at the bottom? Like, that I might be trying to illustrate there, like LDL or like, okay, Ali said LDL. Yeah, this is VLDL. So these are the different categories: cilia, lysosomal storage, peroxisome, biogenesis, mitochondria, and VLDL. Okay, so before we're gonna take a break from the lecture part. And then we're gonna go into kind of the oral words practice. So I need you all to get onto Box on a device. You can take a break from your Vanna White duties. So you should all go onto Box, and you should be in pairs because you're gonna test each other. So you're paired with someone who will be nice to you. If you get onto Box, you'll see that I've shared with you a folder that's called maybe leukocoria cases. Don't open any of the cases yet. but make sure you can find that folder. Okay, did you guys all find the book for you?
Could you share that with me?
Okay, oh yes, I should do that. So one of you is gonna be the examiner and one of you is going to be the examinee, and then you're gonna switch. So, and then I'll have you guys open up, you guys will start with case one, you guys will start with case two, you guys will start with three, four, five, like that. And then you'll just, once you've done one, you'll switch positions like with each other, like whoever was testing will then be the, get tested. And then we'll, you can move on to the next case. So anyone else need access?
So which one?
And I'd like this to be kind of as real as possible, so don't be too nice here. Hello.
Oh, I see.
How do you, is this you?
Yeah.
Easy. All right, so I think you guys were all about correct. What I read on the website is that I said you'll cover 14 cases in 50 minutes, so that averages to about 3.5 minutes per case. It looked like they're gonna give you the opportunity to do, 7 cases. They used to say, oh, there's 10 total and you just get through as many as you can to pass, but it looks like they've changed it. So I think one major question I had before oral boards was like, how much back and forth are you gonna have with the examiner? Are they gonna be like stone cold where they like don't give you anything, not even like a facial, oh, maybe I should be taking my mask off to talk. Anyway, so but in reality, like they do want to help you. So they may interrupt you and move you on. If it seems like you like have this down cold, like, they might just tell you to move on to the next case because they feel you've already demonstrated enough to pass. And they may also try to redirect you if you're getting off track. So I definitely like had the experience where there was this like really, really terrible picture and it looked like there was like a speck on the picture. And I assumed that was like just a speck, but the examiner told me it was supposed to be an IOFB. But other people taking it that same session were not able to know that that was an IOFB. So it's really variable depending on the person. But they're not going to give you a ton of information, as you ask about the vision. They're not going to like tell you what the visual acuity is because they don't have that information. They have the information that you do, except for what's the correct answer and what things you should list about it. But also, like, if they keep telling you all this information, that's going to waste your time. I had one examiner who it was clear to me based on the fact that the head examiner kept like going in and out of his room, like where he was like taking too much time and like candidates were like coming out late, where they're trying to like do an intervention on him because he kept like giving you all this information. Then it was like taking like, 8 minutes to do one case and it's like, you don't know what's going to pass and we don't get through all the cases. So that's why there's not a lot of back and forth. And, usually the cases are such that you should be able to guess what's the top diagnosis just based on the information they give you. You won't have all the information, but just guess what's the top and kind of go with that. So you did this. So I'll give you 3 minutes for the case, and then I'd like you to give your, co-resident some feedback. So I'll... this is my preferred format for the answers. Don't waste a lot of time because you have that limited time, like describing like, oh, the macula and the vessels and the optic nerve all appear healthy in the right eye and then the left eye. This is a fun color fundus photograph. That's gonna kind of waste your time. Really focus on the main things. Like there is, optic nerve edema with, obscuration of all the vessels on the optic nerve head in the left eye. As far as the differential diagnosis, I prefer to put it front at the top, right at the beginning, because that helps me remember what questions to ask, what things to look for on the exam later on. But some people put that later together with the most likely diagnosis.
So you don't need to be like this kind of image and like describe it.
I didn't do that at all. I just said
this
is an optic nerve edema.
Yeah.
There
we go. Yeah, we spend way too much time in FA. Like,
I know.
This is
But if
so
you need to, but maybe you need to stall because you're like, I have no idea what the differential diagnosis of optic nerve edema. Then you can like, you know, spit out that stuff while your brain is working. I can't really talk and think at the same time. So anyway, any questions of other questions about this? And then we'll get started. Okay. Hopefully I have time to run through more cases. So
and is the format that you, I've not done mock all boards, I'm sure we'll do that at some point, but is the format that you have the case beforehand, like before you walk into the room, or you walk into the room and then they present you the case?
So you're in the, you get in the room and then they have like an iPad and then they pull the case and then once you're done with that, then they pull up the next case and the next case. You don't have time to think about it without them there. Okay. All right. So, I was going to do one practice one. Okay. Who wants to volunteer for the practice one? You'll get a prize.
I can do it.
Okay. All right. I'm going to give you the prize right off the bat. You get to choose a finger puppet. You must wear it well.
It's a good pizza pig.
I
get the cow. All right,
so here you go. This is a 2-year-old female whose parents have noticed has a left exotropia.
Okay, so you have fundus photos of both eyes, and in the left eye you see macular dragging with straightening of the vessels, as well as a kind of fibrous scar moving from the optic nerve temporally. So my top three differential items would be persistent fetal vasculature, fever, or ROP. And so additional history, you'd want to know their birth story, if they're premature, if it was a complicated birth.
They were not born prematurely.
You would want to know like any sort of visual, like what sort of visual activity they're noticing in this eye. You want to know family history and any other history of eye issues or genetic eye problems. And then for exam in a 2-year-old, you want to see if they can, you know, read any optotypes or letters or fix and follow in that left eye especially. Pupils, pressure, full dilated eye exam, and then ancillary studies, you probably want a exam under anesthesia and FA as well as OCT to look for any leakage, which would help you differentiate between PFV and fever, and then blood testing or a cheek swab for genetics. And then I think my most likely diagnosis would IV PFV, and then prognosis, discussed that the vision likely will not develop normally in this eye and the patient will have amblyopia. However, if it's PFV, it shouldn't be highly progressive and it would be a unilateral disease, whereas with fever, there's potential for involvement of the other eye.
Okay, great. Wonderful. I think you we're definitely within time and you really hit the major points. I'll just show you like the slides I prepared for the examiners for each case. So there's the top differential, he got it right there. Family history, prematurity, those are key points there. I guess you kind of alluded to the FA and whether the other eye is vascularized or not. Usually PFV is unilateral, so the other eye will be like totally normal, whereas in fever, it's usually bilateral but can be really asymmetric, so there may be just like non-perfusion in the other eye. And the OCT does help to look for retained inner layers in the fovea as a clue to fever. And then to really evaluate for PFE, it helps to get a, and distinguish the PFE from the fever, it helps to get the axial length, because oftentimes that PFVI will be shorter, whereas the fever, they'll be the same size. And then also to look for elongated ciliary processes. Genetic testing, as he mentioned, and then, yeah. So, and then I just added an extra thing at the bottom for extra pimping if you feel like you want to give that to your co-residents. So, okay, so I think we'll get started with this part. So you can each, I think it was like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or something like that. So you can figure out which one of you is going to be tested and test be the tester first, and then we'll just, I'll let you know when 3 minutes is up. One of you needs to look at the examiner, and the other needs to look at the examining one.
I think the right eye.
Both need, we need two laptops.
Or you can look on the phone.
Scars might be. The left eye definitely has.
So
I can see the optic nerve, and the vessels kind of look straight through the walk peripherally. It's a little bit concerning that there's no like maybe avascular retina or something going on there as well. Differential would be ROP, fever.
Back to
those would be my top three. On history, I would want to know birth history, if there are any family history, have any eye problems or genetic problems. And I'd want to know what visual symptoms or problems. They've been present since birth, or if they have developed over the last few months, what kind of visual behaviors they're seeing.
We want to do cataract surgery.
What's next?
Exam.
On exam, this infant would likely probably need an exam under anesthesia, but I would want to know vision, pupils, pressure, cataracts, or anything developed, and then looking at posterior pole, looking at see if there's pain vascular retina or not. At this time, I'd also want to call an MRI to see if there's any. Neovascularization or neovascular retina. I'd also like to figure out if there's this art going on there. Probably do genetic testing at that time.
What do they say?
Or blood work.
Okay.
Codes.
Got it.
I would tell the parents that this is a
sporadic. Oh, no, they're only 6 hours.
Genetic condition, which is unlikely that the eyes will develop normally, especially that right eye. I question its ability to see well, because I can't see its optic nerve from one eye as well. But that it might, the left eye might benefit from some laser beam to the avascular first to kind of prevent its progression.
Okay. Now you can discuss and give each other feedback.
Well,
I know, I was like, that's why I didn't put it on there. Things are going on with the PFE codes.
Is that just, is that like fiber tissue or is that just reflection?
I don't know. Just like,
and we had one new one yesterday, and it was like that last.
Keep going. Are you guys ready to start the next one, or? Oh, they're still going because they're You can, yeah, you, are you guys ready to start the next one? Okay, we have technical difficulties.
Why did I start one?
All right, start the next one down.
Oh, look at three now.
And then they're kind of joining.
That graph, it looks like the right eye is back up there like this part.
That makes more sense.
Sorry, that was my bad, I forgot.
White pupil, looks like you can see some vessel posteriorly.
We did three, you wanna go to four then?
Cataract, retinal detachment, something like coats, fever, PPMA. Retinoblastoma, a little something like a differential.
Yeah.
Like device history, if you don't know about.
This is fever.
Family history, excuse problems in the history of eye trauma. It could also be a blurring membrane.
Four.
Like stage five R. Okay.
Ocular surgeries or history.
Let's do four.
Four, okay.
There is a history of trauma.
I'm ready.
Okay.
So four, for
exam. Of how easy this kid is to examine.
Oh, that's what you did?
Yeah, but they gave you
close examination.
Labels, so.
Oh, okay.
And the slit lamp, and then of course the eye.
External photogram of an eye.
I also
want to
get a
chorea. And then vascularized retroretinal membrane and elongated ciliary processes.
Okay.
Top three differential items would include.
Both eyes, especially if this is a retinal detachment, to see if they're in the ground.
PFB.
Yep.
Anterior PFB, retinoblastoma,
on exam, or
cataract.
Like, that's
especially family history. Examination besides this, see if the lateral glimpse of light. Pupillary reaction, vascularization, like where?
I mean, do they have much to say here?
I can't sort of that, then you don't have retinoblastoma with that.
Compression in eyes two, correct.
They don't give a
consider
vision
genetic testing at that
okay. So the non thing is more like a tricycle eye.
And so
there would be a red
eye.
Like
that eye is 2 millimeters shorter.
This is the tricycle eye.
So that would support the diagnosis of anterior precision of the vasculature. As for prognosis. Talk about how developing amblyopia is important in this eye.
They also talk about
say that the posterior pole is relatively unaffected.
So what is that?
So I guess presumably very
exactly. I don't know what your patient
got
from that surgically cropping membrane.
They're little B scans.
I mean, presumably it's connected to the lens, right?
Yes.
So I guess we do cataracts.
You just watch these kids.
Just
kind of like lens ectomy, membrane ectomy.
You can see pretty good after that.
They can grow it on toe.
Really
so he's got a test. This guy's got a test.
Yeah, you guys can just keep going back and forth.
The other eye, I do the
same. Like,
to do an RD.
So,
like,
this is an extra.
Okay.
It looks like it's plastic, but
like
this.
It's probably got, it looked like there's a.
That's why I kept thinking, like, I'm thinking it's a cataract, but then, like,
yeah, it looks like they're supposed to be.
I was kind of trying to
go.
Well,
what we were
using is
a management
yeah,
section
yeah,
says
for
the
RD. I was doing this at like 11 o'clock.
But it sounds like when you get the post traumatic high school eye.
Just keep it broad.
Okay.
Would you go with
external photograph?
I did operate on that.
Yeah,
unfortunately. So and Ashley brings the like tail back, and then there's like this crazy white membrane behind the and then like
so there's all three.
Weather is a
well, yeah,
like,
or coats.
You know,
I was like, I can
like tried to like just get to
like a
and see the retina. I realized I like made a
big
so
lens or
what
and then I dream like see retina activate and then like oil.
Okay, no, you're in the right direction. So, rock,
so
the guardian as well.
Okay, those are my top three.
Okay.
I would want to know, this is it's noted on your liquids off of your blood, how long ago this was needed, like 0.5, 0.1, what the visual would, the vision was like before this one noted, or what the vision you're having now, it was like, not good. If they're having any eye movement abnormalities, that may suggest that there is a mass.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, I think
how about common? Why would a kid detach?
This
why are kids are pulling balls?
What's that?
Right?
Yeah, that's the first thing.
Trauma?
Yeah. Well, it's like I mean that's the one of like that's a micro deal. That's a very small up.
Okay, Sam.
Sam, I would like to have you know vision pressure.
Oh, it's oh. I was like, this looks like
this
kid's in this super.
It has a chronic RD.
I did think it was what you mentioned. I was
gonna say, likely probably have a limited view of
bowels.
Okay, so I need an EUA with a B scan.
So B scan shows thickened choroid and total
retina.
Yeah, I realized there was a so when it
came with a history of high myopia and like the trauma, which was
for 10-year-old ones. What number is that?
Six, five.
Number five has an error in it, do you guys know?
What's that?
So
about the management plan.
Small eye.
Oh, yeah, okay. Let's do that.
Oh, it's like oh. So this eye. I've definitely discussed that
you
can try to
do
it. And then tear the
otherwise
quite low. You can do surgery and get some better anatomic compensation to be able to prevent ptosis.
They have UVIs on the
different high risk of vasodilation and all sorts of things.
So,
that like
this year,
one
You have slanting fissures.
So we got an 8-year-old boy, sudden onset blurred vision in the right eye. We have a photo, a fungus photo of the right eye.
My
answer is going to be
certainly
not from
one more family.
Look
at
three pictures.
Right
eye. There is a large retinal detachment.
Could also have
a large retinal tear.
Then you've got the
left eye, you have a CME, but
other tests that I've
want separation of vision rest layers. So differential diagnosis given both things could be X-linked rest pieces. Or just general traumatic attachment.
Is there any history that you can give me?
I guess.
No, just a young male.
Don't really.
I think my differential would be
history. A ton else other than a family history.
I would say the most likely.
Exam.
Or some prognosis. I believe this would be
ancillary studies. You can do certain, you know, CT, which looks like
two surgical
did, and then a B scan
to fix the okay, so retinal detachment.
F A to look at the other eye. And then
oh, this is about the left eye.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't. Left eye is terrible.
These abnormal blood vessels weren't.
There are something that you recommend
that
you try in the left eye to look at this.
This looks kind of translucent.
I don't know, this is the world they
pill.
Like, they put them on diamonds
or
something.
It's kind of like.
So you can see it through the If they give you are they going to give you
the pieces on it?
They won't try and like trick you.
No, I don't think they're not trying to trick you.
Yeah.
I saw a lot of
accidents. I can see what this is actually.
That doesn't, that looks like.
Well, yeah,
B
to
B.
I thought it was going to be like RP. Yeah, no, that's
supposed to be.
Okay, well, you already looked at the
I already looked at one.
Oh, okay.
Oh,
why
no,
would,
wait, two is two.
We just
take
two.
Because the RP
all the way down there.
Because you'd see through it where you wouldn't. I think if you had this focus laser.
Oh,
I think we could wrap it up.
Yeah. And then just look at the folks. I'm not a
lot
of reflex.
Yeah,
so
fresh. Like,
I think there's the classic relationship sort of wheel spoke. Isn't that the pattern?
Yeah,
you know, a few of them. Millimeters shorter, but it's also on the
there's a cataract. There it is, a blood pressure. I want to do a piece scan in the back.
They're like, here's that this whole way. You can look for a much get a better view back to it, especially if you can't see. I wonder if you can see the stock history.
Oh, that's already taken off. But the market cap of neurons are massive. But right now, like, they're just worth like 0.000. It's like worth nothing for coin. So
it's like Patel, but like for Bitcoin.
I mean, I think
So.
I mean, I think there's like a, there's probably a good chance that you run into just like Dogecoin there. Because everyone that missed Dogecoin is trying to jump into Yeah. Well, but the funny thing is the next one is the sample
talk about this.
We'll
do an FA to see if it works.
Yeah, so yeah, so they intentionally create Shiba Inu as like the Dogecoin killer that was that runs on. So it runs on Ethereum. But Sambo coin runs on Solana, which is like
yes,
in theory like a Ethereum killer.
I had no idea
you
Can you give a ground round?
You have an extensive understanding. When you
I was like early on, but I'm like very
do you guys have I'm sure questions might have come up, so or issues you have. One issue that came up is I would have observed this eye that was hypotenuse from retinal detachment with like pretasis. But due to various reasons, I operated on him. He did like briefly like seemed like he had better vision than for a couple months. But then after a couple months, he started like hiding under his blankets because I think maybe the eye was kind of uncomfortable. So anyway, it's detached again. So that's that. Other questions that came up with the cases that, or just about the oral boards or anything. We'll move on.
Good question.
Yes.
The one that was retinoblastoma, what
yes.
was toxocariasis on the differential?
Yes, it should be. Yeah.
No, just why other than it just looking white because they're.
Yeah. It's not like I don't think toxo would cause those like mass like lobes, you know, that you saw. It would have been like more just diffusely vitritis.
Okay.
So, but you got to come up with something. Like, even if it's, like, very obviously this, like, you still have to list other things on your differential and do other testing for that. So, because they always want you to keep in mind, like, oh, what if I'm wrong? So, but I guess it's like that in real life, too. Like, sometimes it's like, yeah, this is, like, 100% this, but, like, let me just run in my brain through other things it could be to make sure what else I need to be thinking about. Other questions? Okay. Do you want to keep score like closer to you, Abigail, so you can see the screen?
Yeah.
I brought a secondary whiteboard.
Oh yeah, this is amazing.
Oh my gosh.
I wasn't sure
yes.
if there would be secondary whiteboard. I wasn't sure if there would be a the whiteboard would still be there because it's like maybe obsolete technology. Okay, so we're gonna get down into the RP, LCA, cone rod, inherited diseases that affect the retina and the rest of the body. You know, there is a lot of them, and most of them have this RP-like phenotype. And then the various subcategories we talked about. So we'll start with the cilia, and then we'll kind of go down through the rest of the organelles. We talked about the fact they're usually autosomal recessive, and a lot of them have neurological problems. What's another name for ciliopathies?
Renal retinal.
Oh, very good. Yes, so renal retinal disorders. So that's the easy way for you to remember that all of these ciliopathies do affect the kidney, even though it's not in your textbook. I asked. <They'll be off. laughs> Okay. So what are some names of these ciliopathies?
Bardet-Biedl.
Yes, Bardet-Biedl.
Alström.
Alport does affect the kidneys and the retina, but it doesn't it's not
June.
Not a ciliopathy.
June.
So.
June?
Yes, I don't have no idea how to pronounce that, but we'll take June.
Is Usher also a ciliopathy?
Usher is a ciliopathy, but, and I didn't include it here because I feel like you all know Usher, but I should probably, for completeness, put it on here. Okay.
Joe Bear?
I think someone said Joe Bear. Senior, but yes. Okay, excellent. Oh, so I thought, so what kind of kidney problems do these people have? I thought it was interesting that they have cysts and they have nephronophthisis, which is like phthisis of the kidney. So, oh, senior Loken, we didn't mention, or Meckel. So tell me about some systemic manifestations, or let's see, maybe I have photos. Let's see what happens next. Oh, no. Okay. So which of the, what of the ciliopathies, which of them affect the kidney? Yep, all of them, correct.
Count that.
You were the loudest.
You're not the right one. You're the loudest.
Okay. And then let's see what other else. Okay, so which one is this? Which part of the brain looks abnormal?
There's
a tooth. Yes.
There's a tooth.
There's
a tooth in the cerebellum.
I don't know.
Is that supposed to be?
That looks like a tooth.
Yeah, this one's a chorioretinal coloma.
Oh, I see.
It's a what?
A coloma and then a tooth.
Okay, so that is a Joubert. Here's a quick look at all the other ones. Okay, how about this one? Barta beetle, most popular one. What did you say?
Like a super
baby.
Okay. Okay, how about this one?
That's June.
June.
Yeah, I had no idea what a thoracic dystrophy looks like. It looks quite scary. Okay. And then how about what are the systemic manifestations of Alström?
Cardiomyopathy.
Very good.
Short. Obese.
Okay, excellent. I don't know about the last two. They were cardiomyopathy and short and obese is what he said. And then Meckel.
Encephalocele.
Very good. And then how about senior Loken? This is, I think, Nico's pet disease. So senior Loken actually only has like the retina and the kidney. So very good, excellent. I don't know how who's winning right now.
We're on the front's winning by 2 points.
The front is winning. Oh.
Retail
is that what that boiled?
Oh, this is what Abigail takes notes on.
just retina.
So back to the categories. We're gonna do lysosomal storage next. And just a reminder about them being recessive and having neurological problems. Okay, so what do lysosomes do?
Break things down.
Yeah, they break things down. What are some names of lysosomal storage disorders that affect the retina?
Cyanidosis.
Can you say that again?
Cyanidosis.
I'm not familiar with whatever disease you're saying. Sialidosis? Oh, okay. Maybe it is a lysosomal storage disorder that affects the retina. I just wouldn't know. So I'll take your word for it. Mucopolysaccharidosis. Yes. Very good. Very good.
Is that the lysosome?
K-saps?
Is it bat?
Hurlers.
Yes, Hurlers is one.
Gauchers.
Fabry and Tay-Sachs, those are also lysosomal storage disorders that affect the retina. We're currently focusing on the ones that give like a more RP-like phenotype versus the phenotype of those other ones.
NCLs.
Yes, NCL. So what does NCL stand for?
Fatten disease.
Yeah, so the NCLs are, I know the C stands for steroid. L stands for lipo something. Maybe lipofusion?
Yeah, lipofuscinosis.
Gnosis? Okay, and then N is for, what is the N for?
Neuronal.
So that's AKA Batten disease. And why do, why should we care about diagnosing Batten disease? and distinguishing it from just RP where it's only gonna affect the retina.
Like modified
die.
Stuff.
Yeah, because sometimes like it's one of those things where it can kill the kid and they might present to your eye clinic and you diagnose them with like RP. But that could be the first sign that they're gonna have experience this neurodegeneration that will eventually lead to death. What's the inheritance of NCL or Batten disease?
Autosomal
recessive. Yes, autosomal recessive, just like many of these disorders. Okay, so the mucopolysaccharidoses, our expert here named all of them. And then the other things are alpha melanocytosis, which is like a mucopolysaccharidosis, and then cystinosis. So in the mucopolysaccharidoses, what is building up?
GAGs.
Glycosaminoglycans.
Yes, GAGs or glycosaminoglycans. And then how about cystinosis? What is building up?
Cystine crystals.
Yes, cystine. And then, do any of these have non-autosomal recessive inheritance?
Yes, Hunter.
Yes, Hunter. Yes, we all know that from med school, maybe. Or
X.
I don't know why they picked that one.
Yeah, with the X. Hunter is X linked. Okay.
Hunter's consent.
The X.
Hunters need their eyes to see.
The target.
She's
yeah.
An X.
So.
Yeah. So I just put this picture up here because the Batten disease causes more of like a bullseye maculopathy, but it can cause more diffuse retinal, like RP-like picture. And then these are more like a typical RP-like picture. So let's talk about the systemic problems. We talked about the neurodegeneration and death. How about the mucopolysaccharidoses? Do they experience neurological problems?
Yes.
Yes, they do. And then what other problems do they experience? I don't know if those are fatal. Someone else might.
Faeces.
What
is
like cognitive
corneal clouding?
They have coarse faeces. Abnormal eye.
Corneal issues.
Great. Yeah, so let's talk about the other eye problems. So I put up a picture, which up here, over here, which disease do you think this goes with?
Earlier.
Sure. You go bother. One of them. And then what other. What other eye problems can these mucopolysaccharidoses get?
They get opacifications of the lens.
Okay, I'll take your word for it that they get lens opacification. What other problems can they get?
I think a hunter can get exophthalmos.
Okay, exophthalmos in hunter. They also get optic atrophy. And then here's some picture of cystine crystals in the cystinosis. All right, so we talked about the neuro problems in all these diseases. Does cystinosis have neuro problems?
I don't think so.
Not really.
Just their kidneys and their brain.
And then we talked about the differences between, you know, where Batten disease can lead to death. This is the picture I chose for death.
He's
gonna
feel
for Halloween.
Yeah.
And then we talked about
the
horse species and the. And basically, I just grouped the alpha melanocytosis together with the mucopolysaccharidoses. Okay, what systemic problems? I heard kind of mentions of this. Do cystinosis patients get?
Kidneys.
Kidneys. What exactly is wrong with the kidneys?
RTA.
RTA. What type of renal tubular acidosis? 1, 2, or 3?
Two.
Excellent. This comes up on opto questions like 3 times, and I would always get it wrong every single time. Okay, what kind of electrolyte abnormalities in the blood are characteristic of RTA type 2? How about potassium? Is that what's on it?
High.
I don't know. I have to look at the answer. And then
okay,
phosphate, phosphorus.
Such confidence.
Loudest.
Low K.
Okay, low K
low.
And low K.
I'm going to waste that point. Take my 5 for that.
Abigail's taking negative points.
If you answer with confidence, you are wrong.
Yeah, you answered with confidence, so I believed you.
So
whenever I get pulled, you just give us the wrong answer.
Oh, sure.
And I'm like, yes, that sounds right.
You get points for the confidence, so it'll even out.
Alright, I feel like you guys probably remember more about this than I do. And then the dwarfism is because the low phosphorus causes rickets. Okay. So what is the difference between like cystinosis and homocystinuria? So in terms of like the retina, we just talked about what kind of phenotype does cystinosis have?
RP.
Yeah, RP like phenotype. And then the anterior segment, what happens in cystinosis?
There's
crystals
in
the cornea.
Yeah.
And then in the rest of the body, we just talked about the renal tuber acidosis. How about homocystinuria? What happens in the rest of the body? Do they want you to like make sure you know of
clots?
Yeah,
clots. Okay, and then what happens in the anterior segment?
Lens dislocation.
Lens dislocation. So their thought process is like if you're taking this person to surgery for their lens being dislocated, you need to make sure you have an accurate assessment of their preoperative risk and what you need to do about it. So. Homocystinuria can create like a bullseye type of maculopathy. What is the pathogenesis of homocystinuria? What is the protein that's affected by the mutation? I think this came up on tests, otherwise I wouldn't have it here. It looks like it's cysteine, cystathione beta synthase, which converts homocysteine to methionine. So basically these people can't break down that homocysteine and it builds up and it's homocystinuria as opposed to the cysteine building up in cystinosis. And then what direction does the lens dislocate?
Down and in.
Down and in homocystinuria in contrast to Marfan, which is up and out. Okay. She's giving herself 2 points for that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Anna is here to play.
And then what's the treatment for cystinosis?
Cysteamine.
Someone said something else very confidently, but
cystinosis. Didn't hear anything. Nothing was said.
Just kill words.
I say words.
It may not be the right word. At least I say words.
All right. We covered cilia. We covered lysosomal storage. We're still in that RP, LCL, LCA, cone rod type of thing. So next is peroxisomes. So, are you okay there, BK?
No.
Okay. So what do peroxisomes do?
Break things down also.
They also break things down. What do we mean by biogenesis? So the peroxisomes degrade the lipids, whereas lysosomes degrade like all sorts of different things. And then as far as biogenesis, we just mean like the function of the peroxisomes is affected, that either they're having trouble forming or they're not getting their proteins in. Tell me about these peroxisomal disorders, if someone can name one of them.
Zellweger's.
Zellweger, very good.
Adrenal leukodystrophy.
Neonatal adrenal leukodystrophy.
Rapsum's
disease, very good. So basically, those three diseases are all kind of on the spectrum of Zellweger syndrome. Infantile Rapsum disease is also together with that, whereas adult Rapsum disease, instead of like affecting all of the peroxisomes, it's just one enzyme, so it's not as bad as being not able to degrade any lipids. It's a more minor thing, and that's why it occurs during adulthood. Whereas these, what kind of systemic findings occur with Zellweger syndrome? And
neurodegeneration.
Neurodegeneration, so it can be pretty bad. And then another word is cerebrohepatorenal, so those other organs can be affected. And then there's increased phytanic acid. Is the book saying to restrict the intake again?
Yes.
It's confused me because like over the years, initially it said to, and then it said not to, and then now it says. And then
it says something like it won't change the eye, but it will help with the systemic or something.
Okay.
Well,
what?
Okay.
Why would we
Why would we restrict by tannic acid? I don't know, because they could die.
Your PCP, the rest of your body.
Discharge to optom.
So restricting the intake of phytanic acid will help the body, but not the eye. So we're gonna, but we're still gonna do it because we want the kids to live, even if their vision's not good. Oh, right. So sorry, I just showed you the answer. What happens in adult Repsum disease for the systemic findings? Ichthyosis.
That's what I was gonna say.
Yeah.
Yeah, she is.
Okay, so now we're done with lysosomes, peroxisomes, cilia. Now we're moving on to mitochondria. So mitochondria provide energy, ATP. What are, in general, some systemic findings of these mitochondrial disorders?
Fatigability.
Yeah. Fatigability. How about ocular findings?
Ophthalmoplegia
or CPEO or chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia. Oh, and they also have hearing loss. I think of maybe the ears, you know, require a lot of energy too, just like the retina. And then in CPEO, you get this really bad ptosis. And then you can see that although she's trying to look different directions, her eyes really aren't moving. And there's neurodegeneration as well. So why don't we name some mitochondrial disorders that cause a RP-like phenotype?
CPEO.
Kern-Serre. I think CPEO, maybe it's like, it's kind of like, yeah.
Kern-Serre is
okay. Kern-Serre.
Nilas.
Nilas, very good. I don't think whoop is what.
It's
a big sound.
Neuromuscular weakness, ataxia.
Okay. So here's the various. Do we name? Murph and mid. The best two that I have next. Okay. So in Kern-Serre, what is the thing they don't want you to miss?
Heart
block. And then what does MELAS stand for?
Encephalopathy, lactic acidosis, and stroke.
Great. Encephalopathy, lactic acid, acidosis, and stroke. What does MRF stand for?
Encephalopathy.
I think the M is often means maternally inherited because you get your mitochondria from sperm.
Encephalopathy and ragged red fibers.
Encephalopathy and ragged red fibers. Okay.
Damn.
How about NARP?
Neuromuscular weakness, ataxia, and RP.
Neuromuscular weakness, ataxia, and RP. BK is earning a lot of points to the back row there.
Don't count it.
Okay. How about mid?
Deafness.
Maternally inherited diabetes.
Deafness is part.
Diabetes,
yes. Okay, excellent. Oh, just kidding. The M's didn't stand for maternal.
Also,
and then MRF was myoclonic epilepsy and ragged red fibers.
Wrong.
Close enough. I have one out of four. Ragged red fibers is in there.
3 out of 5 by Mike.
All right.
It's 60%.
Okay. This is just a picture of heart block. Okay, so A beta lipoproteinemia. This is where I put a picture of the VLDL there. ApoB is one of those things that is really important for making the VLDL. And there's fat malabsorption, neurodegeneration, so supplementing fat soluble vitamins is key. Okay, let's take a break from this. How are we doing on time? We're doing okay. All right, so we're gonna do some ROP cases. I don't know if you guys need to like take a break and like move around or. I don't know. Yesterday I was like doing a clinical study exam on a 6-year-old that's trying to get his OCT. So I just like, I would do one OCT and then had him like sprint down the hall. And then he was really good at like holding still for another 10 seconds.
It's amazing.
That is us. Okay. We got one person taking a break. Anybody else want to take a break? When I was in high school and I used to fall asleep in class, my teacher had me do push-ups.
Oh, wow.
That was
exactly one, but now I'm 96.
Yes.
Oh, just text me and said,
oh, I have the
Yes,
Are you talking in front of you
guys,
let alone
Wait for the interview day or for this one?
It's the same thing. But like that will completely screw your score if you're like, I think it's pre plus and not plus.
I'm
saying
you
like don't like
first.
That's
like
the big thing. If you
treat
that's most or vice versa,
50%. And the other thing is like I kept getting every time I thought it was zone three.
It's
well.
Always zone two, or yeah.
I was always
well the
focus
don't
point.
Get to zone three.
Well, but they show that it's every
the
all
nasal
the nasal
look okay.
The, of all the nasal is good.
Yeah,
and
but
it
I've
only
never
shows
seen
on the temporal side.
The, like,
I
haven't seen any cases like that.
What?
There were a couple.
Yeah.
I thought they're well, it depends on what numbers you did.
Yeah.
I did like 1 through 3, and then skip 4, then 5 through 10. But either way,
I ended up
like,
doing all of them last night. It's kind of fun.
There's like,
it's like,
gunning a little bit.
No, okay, Catherine loves
about
RF. I don't know if you know this, but she's in the resident room.
Catherine,
let it keep going.
Catherine, like, loves retina.
She loves. I know. She was like, oh no, do I like Pete? I was like,
these are my favorite texts from Catherine.
Oh,
like, every third day, frantically. Do I love retina?
Yeah, I
love
it.
She's like, oh, God,
should I have done Pete?
Literally, last night, she's like,
never heard her say it about the cornea. Well, she's always like, I can't see the cornea. That's why I'm doing a fellowship.
All right. These cases, maybe we'll kind of like just go around calling on people. It's not going to be like in the oral words format. I didn't realize like I had put my mask on at some point again. It's like I can't help it. So I guess I gave the other part of the lecture all with my mask on too. Okay. All right. So ROP. So let's just start. Let's start at this end of the room with Lydia. So Lydia, your neighbor. You know, you're out for a walk, and your older neighbor asks you. You know, her granddaughter was born at 32 weeks, and 4 pounds, which is 14 grams. So, like, she's, you know, she is very chatty, so she knows what you do, and she knows that, you know, premature babies can have serious problems. So she wants to know, like, should she ask you to, you know, go examine your granddaughter at Primary Children's? Does she need an eye exam?
No, she doesn't need an eye exam because it's a child born not full term.
Would you recommend an eye exam in the NICU?
No.
Oh, okay. So she doesn't
they're
need
not
a,
in the NICU, are they? Are they currently in the NICU?
Yeah. So she doesn't need an ROP screening exam. So what are the criteria for ROP screening?
1,500.
30 weeks and 1,500 grams. Excellent. Okay, Abigail. So the NICU is receiving a transfer patient who was born at 24 weeks and 700 grams. He is now 29 weeks and has not had any eye exams. When does he need his next eye exam?
Does he need an eye exam? I think it's like at the equivalent of 30.
Well, would it be like
is that,
no, yeah, in one? It can't be later than 6 weeks.
Oh, from birth or whichever one comes first,
yeah,
right?
Well, either way, this will end up, so 30 weeks.
30 weeks, right. So either way, it's next week.
Yeah, well,
so
technically it would be 31.
It's actually the table,
oh,
I don't know, there might be different answers, different places, but this is like the AAP recommendations, 31 weeks.
BCSC says it's like 31 weeks or 4 weeks after birth, whichever is later,
yeah,
but cannot be more than 6 weeks after birth.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Can't they pay
so,
that?
So 31
weeks. That covers like these like 22 and 23
weekers to have an earlier exam, but everyone else getting them at 31 weeks. So, but if you're born later, then you're not going to get it at 31 weeks if that's, I don't know. I'm not explaining it well. Here's the table. Okay. And then, Ali, at what age does a 28-weeker need their first ROP exam?
So, 31 or 4 weeks. So I think it'd be even 4 weeks, right? Because that
would
be later than 31.
Because it's later than 4 weeks is 32 weeks, which is later than 31. So why is it like this? Like, what's the explanation for these just number of weeks, et cetera? Because what happens, like, you know, has like a kind of a usual time course after the kid's born. They like get exposed to all this oxygen, which shuts down their blood vessel development, and then like after some time, like then blood vessel development resumes, and that's when it can go awry. But there's that time that it takes for it to that process to occur. Okay, so let's go on with the. Wow. So this picture on the left is the current eye exam, and then the so the right. So full.
We for sure need treatment. So it looks like
post
disease and stage three. So two.
Yeah, we'll just. I can't tell. Area. So we'll call this zone one. And then what do you think of like the time course of how quickly this has gotten worse? Is that fast or slow?
Fast.
It's pretty fast. Yeah, it looks like they had no ROP in that area and now they have this like raging stage three hemorrhages. So impressive ROP. Apparently they took the posterior word out.
I just don't call it aggressive.
So, because in developing nations where they get exposed to really high oxygen, you can get something that's like maybe ROP and more powerful red eyes.
I like the vascular definition.
The definition. The definition of like, let's not go into the definition. There's so many definitions that they've like kind of like combined them all into one, but it gets worse quickly. Sometimes there's plus disease out of proportion to the amount of stage three. Sometimes there's flat neovascularization. Sometimes there's shunts developing posterior to the thing. I think it's like the definition is unclear enough that I don't think.
This
looks
bad.
Just
bad.
Bad.
Less than zone one. At least the latest version of iCrop just kind of rolls everything together to one. Okay. So we'll go with Sean. Sean, what do you think of this? Do you think this is like, what stage do you think this is?
Yeah, so, well, so it looks like stage two.
Yeah, I think it looks like stage two.
More than just the demarcation line.
Yeah.
And it's like a damage. Probably, yeah,
zone two.
I
put zone two.
Say zone two.
And then do you think there's plus disease?
No.
I think there's no plus disease. Okay. So what do you think when should we examine this child next?
So this kid has zone two, stage two.
Probably 1 week.
Go on. Examine the kid in 2 weeks. So let's talk about when to treat.
She took her like an hour to make that last night. She kept redoing it.
She made it last night. Just for
Wait, hold on.
She's
Did
in the rest of her
send this to you last night?
Catherine sent me this.
She kept making it over and over and over again. And then she would quiz me to make sure I could like read the key right. Like, see,
well, I still feel confused. Like, what do these squigglies mean?
That's plus disease.
Stage,
well, why is it?
Because it's plus disease in zone one and then plus disease in zone two with stage two or three ROP.
Right.
That's high. That would be
I don't know. I still feel mentally confused because...
Oh, she's
like
she's
why is there this long line, long vessel in the short
true,
vessel?
True, yeah, weird.
Yeah, I don't know where those came from.
Yeah.
I get what you're saying now.
Clearly flattened me.
She was doing too much.
Okay, so in zone one, we treat if there's either stage three or plus disease. We just saw a case, which is like, I think many times the case that there's both raging stage three. But if you just have plus disease, there could be like this flat NV that you can't really see. So that's why we would treat that. And then I guess you could also have stage three without plus disease. So we would treat that too, because that's all pretty bad because it's right there. It's threatening your vision. And then in zone two, the key is that you need to have plus disease and stage three. So Sean, let's say there's like a really sick NICU baby and like the NICU nurses are like, don't touch her, she's gonna die. You know, can you just like take a, you know, 2 second look at just the posterior retina and determine if like some that kid needs treatment?
I mean, you should be able to see the extent of zone one with a
yes.
28.
Yeah, I think you'd be able to see zone one.
And so, yeah, so if you get to zone two, any disease without plus, it's going to be observation.
Correct. So if you're just looking at that zone one, like Sean said, you can figure out if there's stage three in zone one. And then you can see the posterior pole vessels, so you can see if there's plus disease. If there's no plus disease, even if you can't see they're in zone two and you can't see that vascular junction, you don't need to treat them. But I'd probably see them again in a week since you don't know what's lurking out there. So very good. Okay, how about this, Marshall? What stage is this?
So it looks like you certainly have some vascular dilation, maybe a little bit of tortuosity. Maybe I'd give it plus.
Okay, Marshall's
plus.
Going for
plus.
Okay.
And then a zone two. I think I see some areas of NV. Maybe,
I think it's
so
zone
I'd give
two.
Stage three, zone two.
Yeah, okay. So he's calling it stage three, zone two, with plus
with
disease.
Plus.
So would you treat?
Yeah. But like,
you
know, three plus versus plus.
Yeah. How about like, if this was, like, what if Mubarak is saying, hey, this looks like stage two to me. It doesn't really look like stage three. To me, it looks more like stage two.
I believe stage two, zone two with plus disease, you still treat.
Yes, you would still treat it. So it doesn't matter if, you know, Mubarak's right or Marshall's right. But we're probably, who knows who's right.
As
know.
Long as you know if it's plus
disease. But we,
right.
If we determine it's plus disease, then we know
that's,
we're going to
yeah.
treat. But the plus disease determination is quite difficult. So I'll tell you what I do. Is I look at, I like these photos. I like to look at the photos from iCrop. So I look at this, is the most recent one, just came out. At least they're retcam photos and not those like old cryo-wrap photos where you can only see like the optic nerve. So this one, they called it mild pre-plus. This one they said pre-plus. This one they said pre-plus. And then this one they called plus. And then also, sometimes I go to this website, this IROP website, which I put over here, and then they also have examples of 3+.
Do you feel like the dilation is like, makes it plus?
They specifically addressed this in iCrop and said it's everything, and it's not the number one. Very
can scleral depressing
So the question is whether sclerally depressing the globe can cause plus disease. So there are people that say you should look at for the plus disease first before you start mashing around. What I've noticed is actually sometimes the opposite can occur. The kid has facial edema or whatever, that like Alfonso is like so tight compared to their tiny little palpebral fissure, is that you're squishing the eyeball and like cutting off blood flow, and it looks like they have like vascular attenuation, but then if you like let up, then you can see, oh, it looks like they might have plus disease. So I just wanted to show you, I guess, oh, let's see. just wanted to show you that in the eye crop, they put this like thing that they recognize that basically there's a lot of different opinions on PLUS disease. So they kind of like had a panel of experts and they surveyed them in terms of how many, and then they showed the pictures, how many of them thought it was PLUS disease. So I'll show you that. So on this, like red was like everybody thought it was PLUS disease, green was like nobody thought it was PLUS disease, and then in between, like there are various people, numbers of people calling it PLUS disease. So yeah, and that is critical because that determines whether or not you treat. Most of these kids are in zone two. So
got a question.
Yeah.
So when you're doing like a inter and intra observer study like this, how, like, what are you choosing, or how do you compare it to what is considered right?
Well, their point here is that there's no right.
That's crazy.
Well, but maybe for the ones on the very end, there is a right.
Yeah.
And then the ones in between,
yeah.
There's just a, yeah.
So the picture earlier, which is it? Three plus or plus?
Who knows?
You get to decide.
How
are
you
going to
decide?
You
want to treat baby?
So then it almost feels like the retina doctors are just deciding if they want to treat this kid or not,
yeah.
Based on their just stuff.
Yeah.
And if they want to treat, they'll call it plus disease. If they
yeah.
don't want to treat, they'll call it
I'm not going
to
say that doesn't happen.
Okay. I had another question.
Yes, John.
There have been a few. There were a few photos in the simulator and one there where like the hemorrhages. I kind of thought that if you saw those hemorrhages, it was sort of implied NV.
Oh.
In stage three.
Yeah.
Oh.
But it seems like that's not necessarily true based on the standard photos.
Yeah. No. And also like what I've observed like in real life.
Yeah.
Is that there can be.
Sometimes.
So
hemorrhages.
Heme can be still stage two. I think in real life also, like what they've observed with OCTA is that some neovascularization is, I think, happening in stage two. On OCTA, there is blood flow, but it's just not, it just is neat in a ridge and not making these like crazy teeth that go back towards the
extra
red.
That's why I was wrong.
So I think our old thinking that like stage three is neovascularization and stage two is only fibrous tissue might not be correct. That's good to know. Okay, Mubarak. This like looks really similar.
It's the same.
We did not do
another, just another crazy
hint.
So sorry. Okay, Mubarak. What kind of stage do you think this is?
Yeah. So I see a ridge. It does look to be involving like extra retinal fibrous tissue.
Yeah.
Stage three.
Yeah. Yep. This is stage three because it's not just like a thin, neat ridge. It's got all this like crazy stuff going on back here. I think what's happened is this is like a stage two ridge, and then there's also a second one. Sometimes you get these like double or triple things, and this is like stage three over here. And then what zone do you think we're in?
Looks
posterior.
Kind of. I'd say zone one.
Yeah, I think it's zone one. I think if we just use our imaginations, like this is pretty close to the nerve. But I cannot tell on photos, but I like really failed a lot of the cases. So anyway, I started to learn as you do more of the cases, like how to tell the zone, how they include the zone on the photo. So I got better over time. Okay, do you think there's PLUS disease, Mubarak?
There does look to be tortuosity.
Now there is tortuosity and dilation.
Okay,
Mubarak's going to PLUS disease. So how would you manage it?
So this is zone one for that. Any pluses?
Yep. So yep. Very good. So since it's zone one, either PLUS disease or stage three, and this kid probably has both. I guess if you're waffling on the PLUS disease, you'd still treat the kid. All right, and then Tyler, do you you think we should treat this kid?
No.
Okay, when do you think we should see this kid again?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. What kind of things make you think we should see the kid in 1 week? Like, if this kid had what, would you see him again in 1 week? I don't know. Does your textbook say that?
No.
Okay. Okay. So what I would do is, if it's got stage three, or if it's in zone one, I would follow up in 1 week. Everything else, I would follow up in 2 weeks. So, because if it's plus disease, you're treating.
And after you treat, where would you follow up?
I don't think they'll test you on that. But in general, 1 week later.
Can you go back to the photo?
Yes.
So here, what'd you call it in the end? Zone?
I called it zone two.
Okay.
Based
like
on
zone,
my actual exam
two
of the infant.
Stage like zero.
Or is this state, did I mean to, oh, is this one, maybe
I
this was meant to be zone one. Let's see. It does look pretty
wait,
close.
Why? I feel like I saw vessels.
I think the vessels are like ending here temporally, and maybe like that, maybe that's just like here. So if it were zone one, when would you see the kid again?
Well, if it was zone one, I would see them in a week.
Yep.
But I guess what I'm wondering is stage.
Yeah.
I'm wondering like if this is like zone two, stage zero, right? Because there's no.
Yeah. This is
right?
Stage zero. There's no
so
RO there.
Zone two, stage zero, but with plus disease. Where would you see them?
Oh, that's
if
true.
You
that's true.
Plus disease.
I would see them again in a week.
In a week.
I think look.
I should put or plus disease.
Okay.
Doesn't stage zero mean you don't have ROP?
Correct.
Right.
It's just incomplete vessels.
So there's nothing at that junction. It just looks smooth and normal. Good question. Excellent question. Okay. All right, how about this kiddo? When would you guys, let's see. Tony, when would you see this kid again? Wait, is this the same? This is the same kid. Okay. Never mind. Oh, this actually addresses Marsha's question. So, Tony, what does this look
I'd
like
say
to you?
This looks like zone two.
Zone two.
Stage. How is stage three?
I think this is like stage one. I can tell you, like, looking in person, it's just really fine.
That's why. Oh, okay. I thought there was some neovascularization there at the edges.
Yeah, it just kind of looks like that.
So even though there's lots of vessels kind of like branching out there, that's you wouldn't consider that.
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So, you know, peripherally, people can get this. What is the word for when the
pretty
branch? That's like in sickle retinopathy, but basically there's
arborization.
They look like little
arborization. That sounds good. Okay, let's call it arborization. So you can get like a ton of this and not have that much ROP. It doesn't like, I guess it's a sign something's going on, but we don't use that to determine stage or when to treat.
So
definitely it gives you the heebie-jeebies, you know, vessels like going like that.
So my question, I'm a little confused because one of the cases that we did, it like had a circle around one of those like arborization things. And I was like, neovascularization.
Oh, weird.
So then I was like, I thought that's what it meant. Okay. Unless, are you looking for like other signs? I don't
know. No,
like,
I would just look at the, you know, like, it looks like this, I would call it. But if you could find that one for me again, I'd love to look at it together. But it might be a little hard.
So zone two, stage one, that looks like plus disease. And you would follow up in. You wouldn't treat.
You would not treat
because
even though there's plus disease, it's only stage one here.
Well, 1 to 2 weeks.
Sorry, Dr. Hoffman. What? 1 to 2?
Yeah,
no. Okay, I'm calling. Dr. Hoffman's calling. Hi, this is Eileen.
That's
Yes.
What are you
gonna go
with? It seems how I feel.
All I know is that Spari
after a lot of those activities.
Yeah. Yes.
But
we
this one, I
that's one
of my
I can see that.
But the thing is that, like, whether or not to treat this right now determines on you deciding that it's not stage one or
stage
two. Yeah, exactly.
I know, because looking at that, I would call that stage two.
Yeah.
I treat it.
Right.
I'm willing
so,
to. Because
I would
yes,
need to never see plus enough. Like, I probably want to treat
yeah.
it.
Yes. Yes.
Same middle elsewhere.
So this was pre-threshold.
This would
one,
yeah,
then
it would be technically pre-threshold.
So then that would be a week.
Yeah.
If it's type 2, pre-threshold.
Which is
zone 2.
Zone 2, 1 with.
Actually, they don't include that, so this would be like
no.
Yeah.
There's no
this,
way.
No, that wouldn't be
every type 2 pre-threshold doesn't need treatment. Zone 1. Stage.
That's unfortunate,
so
but I am totally
zone,
willing to help. I actually have already told you
two
spaces,
yeah,
so I'm
yeah,
not
going
to help
that
other people
like,
are not mine too.
You just got to there's no way.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
yeah,
see, because from
right.
the guide, they, when they, that one, they said
the
it was
best?
Out plus.
If
out
the
plus, then
sees
I don't know
it,
what you do.
It must be treated.
That sounds good.
It's like,
okay, I'm a fan too. Okay, I'll tell the residents you said hi in the middle of their lecture.
Dr. Hoffman.
It's okay. It's okay. They're enjoying their break. Okay. Okay, bye.
Everybody, it's follow up 1 week.
Okay. Follow up in 1 week, yes, for the plus disease. Even though that wasn't on my table there.
Does
so.
That, like, we can't really find a spot where this falls. Because they talk about type 2 pre-threshold or, like...
Yeah.
Like just below needing treatment.
Yeah.
If you're in zone 2,
yeah.
it has to be stage 3 without plus,
okay.
but they don't talk about plus disease.
Without stage 2 or 3 in zone
yeah.
2.
Yeah. So.
Okay.
But I just feel like it looks
yeah.
scary and you would.
It's a post-avastic kid. Like, because in real life, like, you know, it's you hardly ever get like plus disease without
two or
3. So that's why it wasn't on my table, and maybe they're not covering it there. So, but in the post-avastin life, anything goes. But anyway, that's a different story. Okay, how about this? Are we on BK?
Yep.
Okay. what do you think of this?
Yeah, so this looks like, I would say stage... 2 to 3, most likely 3 zone.
Yeah, I think 3 because
yeah.
it's got that messiness to it
right.
where it's like behind there and it's got little teeth.
Yeah, I would say zone 2.
Zone 2, yeah, probably because the macula is looking pretty good on this one.
Yeah, and no plus disease.
And no plus disease. So when would you see this kid again?
Stage 3. Let me look at my notes because I don't know. 1 week.
1 week, yes, for the stage 3. Okay. Hope I didn't just confuse you guys further.
I had a question.
Yes,
regarding that.
Yes.
So that picture on the left is just showing that the ridge is not in the picture.
Correct.
That's what I'm saying in zone 2.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah, because zone 2, zone 1, I kind of just try to figure out where I think the fovea would be, and then the edge of that. It might be over here, so we know that this is not in zone 1. And then since we can get a photo of it, we know it's not in zone 3. All right.
When you're on Pete's, Dr. Hoffman or whoever will have you look close to your pole, and then you'll look nasally first. And if you see something nasally, you know you're in zone 2,
yeah.
likely 360. But if you don't, then you're probably looking out farther peripherally in zone 3. But you look temporally.
But it doesn't work on the modules.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
Yeah, the zone determination on the photos is not good. Okay, so we covered, what's the phenotype that we covered already? We just spent all that time covering inherited diseases that affect the retina and the rest of the body. What's the eye presentation that we've already covered?
RP-like,
exactly. What are the other eye presentations that I had on my little overview thing? them up, many colored buttons.
Macular issues.
I have it really small over here. Maybe you can extrapolate. There's fundus hypopigmentation, myopia and RD, and peripheral non-perfusion. So, and, we've only got a little to cover. We're doing great. We're doing well. What's our score right now of the two?
Back table's up.
Front team's up by three.
Front team is up
by
three.
Two, three, four, five, six. No, sorry. Back team's up by three.
Okay.
She's gonna start shouting like Tyler.
Anything.
So the prize is I have some Amazon gift cards, and then whoever the team that wins gets to. There's only two gift cards. You have to decide together how to spend it on behalf of the residents. Okay. All right. So so macular problems. Some gross generalizations is that they tend to be recessive and have neurological problems, similar to like what we've talked about before. And many of them are lysosomal storage disorders. We kind of shouted some of those out when we were thinking of the lysosomal storage disorders. So what are the lysosomal storage disorders that cause cause the RP-like phenotype?
NCL,
mucopolysaccharidosis, excellent, and cystinosis. And so the ones that cause this macular problems are sphingolipidoses as opposed to mucopolysaccharidoses, as well as fucosidosis, and then there's trinucleotide repeat disorders. So sphingolipidosis, I guess what's different about sphingolipids compared to mucopolysaccharidosis, like chemically? Like what are they? Or glycosaminoglycans, which are degraded, having problems being degraded.
Fatty.
Yeah, so the sphingolipids are fatty. Where in our body is that fat important for?
Cell membrane.
Yeah. So their brain, it's important in the myelin. So sphingolipidoses. And then how about the glycosaminoglycans? There are obviously in the brain too, but they're kind of building up in various other parts of the body, the face, the liver, the spleen, as opposed to having more neurological problems here. And then fucosidosis is the sugar. So systemically, we talked about these having neurodegeneration. Is this the kind of thing where sometimes it can be bad and lead to the death, or just like the cognitive delay, or both?
It's death.
Yeah. So definitely, I think Tay-Sachs can lead to death. So here are the various phenotypes. Which one of these diseases cause like a cherry red spot?
Tay-Sachs.
Excellent. Gaucher. So Gaucher, I know in the book it says cherry red spot, but then when I like Google imaged it, why do I have macular halo twice? Anyway, cross that out and put like white spots. So the Gaucher, it seems like maybe looking at Google images, like the white spots are more characteristic. And then how about macular halo?
Second type of
Niemann-Pick. I don't know anything about the different types, but okay, we'll go with Okay. And then how about retinal vessel tortuosity?
Oh,
Fabry,
yeah.
Excellent. Okay, and also the fucosidosis. So white spots, Gaucher. Oh, and what's the inheritance of all of these? Recessive, except for one of them.
Fabry's.
Okay. So here's a bunch of pictures. What do you think this one is? Tay-Sachs with the cherry red spot. What do you think this one is?
Fabry.
They're trying to capture the vessel tortuosity here. How about this one?
Gaucher.
White spots with Gaucher. And then how about this one?
That's
a macular halo, a Niemann-Pick. We're going to go, these two are the trinucleotide repeat disorders, so we'll cover those next. So in Fabry, another name for Fabry is angiokeratoma corporis diffusum. The the way I think about it is that these sphingolipids are like building up in the blood vessel walls and those smooth muscle cells. So it's causing like blood vessel issues kind of everywhere in the skin, in the conjunctiva, the retina. And then they're also, what is this a picture of? And then can Fabry's be treated? Yeah, so there's some drugs that can be used to treat Fabry. So somebody came up with like a list of the different diseases that could be treated. That was Marshall.
Nice.
What are some of the, what are some of these other diseases that can be treated?
Ones I put, I guess, was like LCA, just because of the
LCA with gene therapy.
Incontinentia pigmenti, but mostly just because you can treat like a skin fine, like I guess you can treat like the skin and the eye findings, but like not necessarily
the skin and the eye.
Yeah. Pseudoxanthem elasticum.
Pseudoxanthem elasticum. Wait, how do you?
You can treat with anti-VEGF if you get.
Oh, okay. You can treat the choroidal neovascularization.
Yeah. Can I separate it into like things that are that the vision was treatable, stuff that only the systemic stuff is treatable but not the vision, and then like not treatable at all. So like in that case, it's like vision and systemic stuff that's treatable, at least like symptoms modifiable.
Yeah.
And like vitamin A deficiency, Fabry's disease, cystinosis.
Okay. And cystinosis, and vitamin A deficiency. Excellent. Yeah, so, and then in PXE, it seems like they like to put them on aspirin because they get some sort of, do they get like aortic root dilation or something? Not aortic root dilation. I don't know. What do they get in
aspirin? Don't they get like GI bleeds, cardiovascular?
Do they avoid aspirin?
I don't know how they would treat it.
Okay, someone look up the pseudoxanthoma and update on
you get like, it's something with the elastic.
Yeah, they'll do like vascular surgery for like the cardiovascular manifestations.
Okay, and you look up and make sure about the aspirin if we're supposed to avoid it or
it does seem to avoid aspirin.
Yeah.
Avoid aspirin. Oh, I got it totally wrong.
They do lipid lowering though.
Okay, no. Oh, and they put them on stents. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Okay, pseudoxanthoma, no aspirin, and yes, stents. Thank you, because I believe.
Yeah.
All right, so the trinucleotide repeat disorders. What's an example of a trinucleotide repeat disorder that doesn't affect the eye that you learned about in medical school?
Huntington's.
Huntington's disease. So what's the inheritance of trinucleotide repeat disorders?
Dominant,
because you're getting that copy, bad copy from one of your parents, and then it keeps getting bigger and bigger. Okay, so the two trinucleotide repeat disorders are myotonic dystrophy and spinocerebellar ataxia. Anyone want to tell me anything about myotonic dystrophy?
Frontal balding.
They have that where they like have to straighten out their hand because they like.
Yeah, they have trouble letting go when they
yeah.
grab something.
They can't let go of the doorknob.
Yeah.
Cataracts.
Cataracts. What kind of cataracts?
Christmas tree
cataracts.
Abnormal ERGs.
Okay, abnormal ERGs. I'll have to take your word for it.
I think that's in Duchenne.
Oh, it is in Duchenne's.
Oh, okay. Allie's calling him out that the I'm going
for that.
Minus one. Plus.
She's correct. It's in other neuromuscular issues, so.
Yeah.
She's right. No, in the book, it's like the neuromuscular whole sections. There's other ones who also have ERG problems, too.
Okay.
So,
sounds good. Okay. Possibly. Anyway, we'll resolve this at a later time. Okay, and then spinocerebellar ataxia, it's pretty obvious, you know, ataxia. And then their macular findings, myotonic dystrophy can cause like a pattern dystrophy, and then spinocerebellar ataxia can cause a macular dystrophy. So which one of them causes pattern dystrophy?
Myotonic.
And then which one causes macular dystrophy? Spinocerebellar ataxia. And then... other eye problems with myotonic dystrophy. I got this picture last year. Anyway.
Is that the Melania White House?
It's the Melania White House plus what is
oh, yeah.
Okay.
Are those Christmas trees?
Christmas trees. This is Melania's Christmas decoration from a couple years ago of the White House.
Wait, there's action like that?
No, not
that.
Oh,
okay.
I
It's like weird white house.
Candies.
And then this is just showing a small cerebellum. Oh, wait, we didn't cover, we forgot about the CPEO in the myotonic dystrophy, if you didn't mention that. So, here we go. Okay, so now we're on to myopia and retinal detachment. We're getting close, and peripheral non-perfusion, how are we doing on time? We're okay. Oh, no, don't, no, we're on to fundus hypopigmentation. Okay, what are some of these diseases that cause fundus hypopigmentation?
Albinism, one point for us.
Albinism, I heard.
Incontinentia.
Yeah, maybe, I don't know, does it cause? Okay.
Tyrosinemia.
Tyrosinemia? I don't know, does it?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll take tyrosinemia. Okay. What else?
And like choroideremia.
Yeah. Okay. So algal and
allergy.
At least favorite.
So what yes. So you guys know all about algal because of your millions of patient consults. How about Wardenburg?
They have like the inherent, yeah, they have the white forelock.
White light forelock lint. And they can have iris heterochromia. How about, so what about the inheritance of ocular versus oculocutaneous albinism? X-linked versus
recessive.
Minus one.
And then.
We got it back.
Tyler.
Plus one and then
and
minus
which one?
One.
X-linked.
Ocular is X-linked.
Ocular is X-linked. Okay, and what other eye findings are there in albinism other than
DIDs?
DIDs,
loss
of nystagmus,
abnormal decussate fibers,
nystagmus,
nystagmus,
and mobile hypoplasia.
Yeah, you guys are going great.
Yeah,
I already got it. I already sent
okay, everyone, abnormal nystagmus because of the misrouting. I forgot exactly what happens, but I think you probably heard electromyocardial. Does he still give you his life lessons lecture? Or he tells you,
no,
like,
someone else told
not to get married, not to have kids, and not to, like, buy a retirement home in Hawaii that's...
of visual potentials in albinism, if you look at ERG.
Okay, so the pattern, the reversal.
You have lots of
why?
You get more
yeah,
nasal
like
fibers that you
that?
Say.
Yeah.
Why does Krill, Dr. Krill say those things?
Things because he's done all those things. So those are his life lessons.
I don't think we got that lecture.
Are those
yet.
All the mistakes that he's made?
Yeah.
So I don't know, perhaps.
I'm sorry that you don't get his life lessons lecture. It's very funny. I mean, it's the albinism lecture, not the life lessons lecture.
Wait, how does albinism and life lessons go together?
We should ask.
Krill discovered this thing about albinism. He
discovered that?
He discovered the difference in like the
ear,
nasal desiccating.
Oh.
Yeah,
Mitchell said that Krill discovered the fact of the decussating fibers.
Yeah, whatever it is.
That's an exciting discovery. It's pretty like significant.
Yeah, that's
yeah, that is.
Okay.
Has it changed anyone's management?
I don't know.
Maybe it helps make the diagnosis.
So how about Chediak, Higashi, and Hermansky Pudlak?
That's like an immuno.
Yeah, they have immune disease.
No. Low platelets.
Low platelets.
Platelets
pale.
Is that in both of them or?
Yes.
Platelets.
But Chediak has neutropenia.
Chediak, you said has neutropenia.
Yeah.
Just add infection, skin ulcers.
Add infection. I've seen someone with that actually.
All right.
It's very unfortunate. There's what I put here. P. Pulmonary fibrosis. I don't think we mentioned.
And I need to add some sort of tyrosine thing.
Tyrosine.
What is it called?
Tyrosinemia.
Tyrosinemia. Okay, I'll add
that
on.
You definitely.
You definitely.
Wait, what's
no,
that?
You keep saying it. I think we should keep
is
just
is
tracking.
But that's yeah. But that's in relation to albinism.
Well, you don't.
Okay. Well, anyway, we're gonna resolve the tyrosine.
There's an absence of macular pigment, but it's not in the bloodstream, only in the retina, which is interesting.
Okay, so let's move on to myopia and retinal detachment. This is, I don't know, I tried to find a photo of thick glasses and this is what came up.
Like the photo.
So a lot of these diseases, in contrast to what we previously saw, are autosomal dominant. A lot of them are structural proteins. So, you know, unlike an enzyme, where if you have half, it can like probably do an adequate job of cleaning up, these structural proteins, half is not enough. So what are some of these diseases that cause myopia and retinal detachment? Stickler syndrome.
Allergies.
Allergiel is,
we already covered that.
We covered that previously.
They still cause myopia.
Wagner.
Okay, Wagner. What gene is mutated in Wagner?
COL2A1.
A2.
No, that's Stickler.
It's COL2A1. Okay, what other diseases are there? What other diseases cause myopia and retinal detachment? And ectopia lentis?
Our fans.
Our fans. Okay.
2 points because we both.
Also, we have NOBLA. Marfan, what gene is mutated in Marfan?
Fibrillin.
Fibrillin, excellent.
Yeah.
How about wild Marchesani? Okay, it can actually be fibrillin as well. It's weird. It's the same gene, but it can cause like opposite. In some ways, opposite effects, or it can also be Adams T10. And then you've got NOBLOK, that's collagen 18. Wagner's Versican, VCAN. Okay, I think we probably know a lot about the other ocular findings. How about systemic findings of Stickler?
Micrognathia pyrotin.
Yeah, also you're very familiar from all the NICU consults that you did for. Or maybe, do they have you doing those anymore?
They have all the time.
Okay.
Maybe just me, I don't know.
People are shaking their head, but basically anytime, you know, a kid's born with like a small jaw and, you know, yeah, they have to like intubate them and stuff, and they, yeah, they face hypoplasia, and then they consult ophthalmology to rule out Stickler syndrome.
How often makes you rent them in the NICU?
Yep, and then you do retinoscopy because the myopia is congenital as opposed to other myopias, which develop later. Okay, oh, and then they're vitreous. I don't think we really, this is not something you're going to be tested on, so, and then they got arthritis. NOBLOK gets encephalocele, Marfan, and Hwang Marchesani, I think you know about. Okay, we're going to do peripheral non-perfusion. So what diseases cause like peripheral non-perfusion and stuff in the rest of the body? That's true. Sickle cell does cause that.
What was your question again?
Diseases that cause retinal non-perfusion and problems in the rest of the body.
Fever.
Incontinentia.
Fever can. Yep. Incontinentia pigmenti. Coats plus. Yep. Okay. Good. Excellent. So with Coats, there's like Coats plus, which can cause like. What else does Coats plus have with other than Coats?
Neurodegeneration.
Neurodegeneration, and then. The name of this one kind of tells you they have bone problems. What's the inheritance of most of these things?
AR except Nori.
Yes, very good. What's they're all autosomal recessive except Nori disease. What is the inheritance of Nori? Oh, actually not all. Okay.
No.
Well, Nori is one exception. What is the inheritance of Nori disease?
Link recessive.
X recessive. Okay, there's one other disease on here that's not autosomal recessive.
Cutis.
Negative. There's one other disease on here. This is something you could definitely be tested on because it's one of the few diseases like
incontinentia
pigmenti. So,
you didn't even say it right.
I'm from Wisconsin.
From Wisconsin.
Regional dialect.
So,
very cool.
Nori disease is X recessive. So, what's the only gender or sex it occurs in?
Males.
Males. You'll only see Nori in males. How about incontinentia pigmenti?
girls, only in girls, why do guys die? Yeah, it's X dominant and it's lethal in the males.
And then we incontinentia pigmenti, obviously they get a rash. What else do they get?
Teeth
stuff. Teeth problems.
Brain.
Good. And brain. They can have seizures. How about the rest of these? These are never gonna be on a test, but Dr. Hartnett may pimp you on these, so memorize them. What?
Mom.
Oh, apparently this. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, I forgot. This LRP5 mutations causing fever can give you osteoporosis, and that can either be dominant or recessive, but you don't have forever. Okay.
Are these like sporadic ever, or are they like always like inherited essentially?
So, when, like, could they be a de novo mutation?
I guess, yeah. Is that like a significant percentage of them, or are you just something to think about?
You had a fever one yesterday that was sporadic. Interesting.
Yeah, I think of like sporadic as being not like a monogenic inherited disease, whereas like have like be the first person in your family to have the mutation, which is like I call it de novo mutation, but you could pass it on to your kids, so it'd still be like a X dominant disease, but you would be, your parents don't have it. You're while you're there.
Okay,
something
so you don't.
Happened.
Okay, so de novo mutation is something you wouldn't consider spread.
Correct. I don't think so.
Yeah, like someone has to get it to pass it on.
Yeah. Okay. The other, okay, so what is the other thing that causes dental problems other than? Jalili. Okay, what does Bieti cause?
Crystals.
Okay, good. And what is this is a picture of? What are these things called?
That's Cardi.
Yes, this is our Cardi disease. Right? What did you say? You can pronounce it in a Wisconsin accent, it's okay.
But no, they're lacunae.
Lacunae, yes, excellent. These are lacunae. And then what is it picturing here in iCardi? Yep, agenesis of the corpus callosum. Excellent. And as we mentioned, Alport syndrome, what does that cause?
Lozenges.
Lozenges?
I don't know. Bernstein pinned me on some sort of lozenge.
They could have temporal atrophy of the macula.
I swear.
That's not going to come up. Maybe it's lozenge shaped. Okay. What else does Alport syndrome cause in the eye, in the anterior segment? Is the most frequently. Posterior lenticonus.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's, isn't it anterior?
I think they can. Technically, they can get anterior lenticonus, but don't like. Just gets too confusing. Okay. And then Alport also gets like kidney and hearing issues. What is the inheritance of Alport?
Recessive X.
Yeah, most commonly X recessive. Okay, you made it to the end. Oh, just in time. Okay, who's our winner?
The back row, Violet.
Okay, the back row. Figure out how to spend these. There's two $50
gift cards. And like, which questions? Kind of those questions.
Oh, there's a lot of
the retinal
moss.
Retinal moss. Yeah, the wall back.
That's what I'm like, this little gem-shaped, like, cough drop.
There's
like,
two. Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were going to... No.
Bernstein like smiled at me.
I'll never forget it.
Oh no, that look. And he's like, you're never gonna get this. I'm gonna sit here and wait for you to try.
When Bernstein smiled, it cracks me.
Okay, thank you guys for being engaged and being here.
Well, I mean, we all have to.
Thank you so much. This was awesome. Yeah,
temporal mac.
Oh, the name is
weird.
Yeah, that's what this is. Oh, that's what she had on.
Well, well, this presents you well.
I still don't see it.
Do you see it in real life?
Nope.
Can I see a photo of the macular one?
Trying to find a lozenge. Cheers. First, he was like, I bet you don't know what a lozenge is, do you?
No.
I was like, you're the one who responds to a lozenge.
Hello?
Oh
my goodness. Oh my goodness.
Introversy
love
that. Yeah, I know, that was so quick.
that's all
last year.
Last year.
Is it the same one?
I just watched the beginning when he said I'm from Minneapolis, Minnesota. I'm also interested in that.
I know.
Yeah, yeah.
He only goes once and he gets it wrong.
No, I think what Nico said was that later he had gotten like more though, right? But he didn't video. It wasn't like in the video or like maybe the clip was.
I only watched the beginning
also. When I watched it, I thought it was a joke. Because and I thought it was like some kind of parody thing. Like it wasn't an actual game show. Like I thought it was like an SNL skit
of the lecture in the food.
Yes.
No.
Hey, what do we want to do with the extras? We're gonna bring it to the resident.
No, it's throw it all away.
No, I mean bring it to there's other options.
Give it to the main. Take some of the VA.
You to the VA.
Yeah, right. That's the take home point.
Well, the loop, baby.
Yeah, I feel like lectures like this will turn me off. I don't like learning about this kind of stuff.
I don't think that was the intent.
No, kind of.
It's fine.
The main thing I got at
Lecture's
medical school is that it scares me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't like things with like a lot of individual pieces of information.
Yeah, I know.
It was like very tight as not to be able to.
Yeah, and then you texted us that it was open.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Then I, like the last couple of weeks, I spent so much time on trying to get my visa appointment
because
it's even close out.
Yeah.
And I just, like, I was...
Here, why don't you take whatever you want, I'll take the rest of the media. Yeah. Nice.
How was the rest of the lecture? You said to take a phone call.
Yeah.
Much. And I sent you the email about the patient with the field.
Okay. Yeah, I gotta call them. I